Yeah, the integral energy balance in its full form of course looks scary with so many terms in it, but we will see now how to simplify it, and so we are going to discuss about simplification of the integral energy balance equation just like we simplified the integral total mass balance equation. Okay. We did not simplify much the integral linear momentum balance, we only looked at straight away in the applications, but we simplified the integral mass balance equation. So, this discussion will be roughly along those lines. So, let us write down the complete integral energy balance equation. Internal energy in the transient term, enthalpy in the convection term. Right hand side we have rate of heat addition term and then rate of shaft work term. Now, if we consider a control surface where there are multiple inlets and outlets like this, okay, this diagram we have come across earlier also. Okay. Now, how do we simplify? Now, we will make some assumptions. The total energy is uniform in the control volume, okay, which means within the control volume, okay, and total energy is uniform across the inlets and outlets. What does it mean? Within the control volume, the total energy is uniform, and across inlets and outlets, the total energy is uniform, which means there is no variation across the cross section. Okay, now, how do we usually split the control surface? Usually, we split the control surface, let us say inlets, outlets, and then the wall. Okay. And wherever you have a wall, this the convection term does not contribute because velocity is 0. Okay. Now, how do we simplify this term where there are inlets and outlets? Let us see that. We assume that the total energy is uniform across the inlet and outlet, which means that this term does not vary across the cross section area. So, I can take out this term outside the integral sign, that is what I have done here. Okay. And what is left out is the mass flow rate. So, I can write this as m dot, the mass flow rate, into sum of all the energy terms. And if you do this for inlet, you will have a negative sign. Why is that? Because v dot n is positive for outlet and v dot n is negative for inlet. Okay. So, now let us simplify, use this and simplify the integral energy balance equation. Okay, now, for the transient term, also we can simplify. How do we simplify? We can take out this total energy term outside this integral, and what is left out is integral rho dv, which is mass. So, this simplifies to mass into sum of the energy. Okay. So, what is that we have done? We have taken the sum of energy term outside the integral. We are left with integral rho dv, which is mass. So, we have d by dt of, when I say mass, mass of the contents of the control volume. So, mass into the sum of the energy terms. Now, how do we simplify this convection term? The convection term is for inlets and outlets, and so we express that as sum over outlet and summed over inlet, and we have seen that we can simplify that term as m dot, the sum of the energies, and that is what has been used here for every outlet I, and same term here, of course, the negative sign here. Right hand side remains the same. Okay. So, what is the simplification? The total energy is uniform in the control volume and across inlets and outlets. So, the transient term gets simplified in this way and the convection term is over outlets and inlets, which is expressed as the mass flow rate into the sum of the energies. We have also taken into this sign ourselves. Okay. So, now let us proceed further. Let us see how do we simplify this further. Okay. So, the same equation is written here. So, now this looks certainly simpler, we do not have the integral signs. The integral sign was taken into account either variation within the volume or over the inlet and outlet, because we assume it is uniform, in integral signs are gone, and we also expressed in terms of mass flow rate. Okay, now, if we are operating under steady state condition, the left hand side, the transient term goes to 0, and then in a steady state operation, usually the unknowns are rate of heat to be supplied or the rate of shaft work. So, let us simplify that equation taking these two terms on the left hand side. So, rate of heat addition, rate of shaft work on the left hand side. Why is that? Usually the unknowns are on the left hand side. So, we have taken these terms, two terms to the left hand side, and of course, now these terms have been taken to the are expressed on the right hand side. Okay. Now, we will make few more assumptions and simplify further if changes in kinetic and potential energies are negligible. Why is it so? And that is what is shown here. What is that we are going to assume now? Changes in kinetic and potential energies are negligible compared to change in enthalpy. What does it mean? If you have a control volume, let us say only one inlet, one outlet, what is the change in enthalpy between inlet and outlet? How does that compare with change in kinetic energy, change in potential energy? Okay. To understand that comparison and justify this assumption that usually kinetic potential energy changes are negligible, to justify that, we have a small example here. Let us say we have air flowing and then its temperature increases by just 1 degree centigrade, just 1 degree centigrade air is flowing. Okay. And so, the change in enthalpy will be Cp into delta T, delta T is 1, Cp is 1000 joule per kg Kelvin. So, the enthalpy change in terms of per unit mass is 1000, so 1000 joule per kg. Now, let us see what is the velocity change that should happen so that the kinetic energy change is 1000 joule per kg. So, what do? The kinetic energy change is V 2 squared by 2 minus V 1 squared by 2, let us equate that to 1000. Now, of course, the change in velocity required for the kinetic energy change to be 1000 depends on V 1. So, let us take different cases of, let us say, inlet velocity V 1. And what is shown here is as a table, the inlet velocity and corresponding change in velocity that should happen so that the change in kinetic energy is 1000 joule per kg. So, now, if the inlet velocity is 1 meters per second, all in meters per second, okay. If the, let us say, inlet velocity is 1 meter per second, the change in velocity should be 44 meters per second, then the change in kinetic energy is 1000 joule per kg. If the inlet is 10, change should be 36, inlet is 100, then change should be 10. Now, for usual equipments, let us say heat exchanger, distillation column or reactors, etcetera, let us say the inlet velocity is order of 1 meter per second, then the change should be 44 meter per second, which hardly happens. That is why change in kinetic energies are negligible. But let us say suppose you have a steam turbine, you have a compressor, then the velocities are somewhere in this range, let us say order of 100 meters per second, then the velocity can change by, let us say, order of 10 meters per second. So, in those cases you will have to consider the change in kinetic energy term for compressors, steam turbines, etcetera. Coming to the potential energy, what is the elevation required for the potential energy change to be 1000 joule per kg. So, let us equate this g delta z to 1000, and so delta z should be roughly 100 meters. Once again, that is a too large a height for usual process equipments. Remember, that is for just 1 degree centigrade change. Usually temperature changes are larger than that. So, once again the potential energy change is also negligible. Okay. That is why we are going to simplify for a more practical case, I would say, where changes in kinetic and potential energies are negligible. So, let us take the case where there is no shaft work. Why? For usual equipments where, let us say, heat exchanger, distillation column, there are no shaft work. Okay. Shaft work plays a role when you have a pump, compressor, or you have a stirrer, etcetera, then there is shaft work. Okay. So, this goes to 0, we are not going to consider V squared by 2 term, the kinetic energy term and the potential energy term. So, it gets simplified to just m I dot into h I cap, both for the outlet and for the inlet. Of course, now becomes very simple. This is the energy balance mostly used in process calculation course. Usually, you would have considered a steady state process, and let us say without, if it is without shaft work, and you would have used the energy balance to find out the heat to be supplied, and this is the form of energy balance which you would have used. In this simplest case, we can probably call this as enthalpy balance only under this condition, and we should know that is the most, one of the most simplest forms of the total energy balance.